Some of you may remember a few weeks ago, we started a sermon series that we called Model T. And we've been looking at a church in the Bible that was literally one of a kind. Look at what the Bible says about them in 1 Thessalonians 1. Paul wrote, "And so you became a model to all the believers in Macedonia and Achaia. The Lord's message not only rang out from you in Macedonia, in Achaia, your faith in God has become known everywhere." And don't miss what the Bible says there. Because scripture tells us that this group of believers were so amazing, so committed, that their faith in God became known all over the world. And the Bible doesn't say that about any other group of people, which leads us to ask a very important question. And that question is, what made this church so different? What was it about this group of people that made them so infectious and so contagious that they were considered to be a model for all the believers? Well, what we've learned over the past few weeks is that this group of people were known for their hard work, their generosity, their love for others, and their continuous effort to make a difference in spite of all the opposition they faced. Now, even though this congregation was amazing in so many areas of life, they didn't understand everything there was about following God because most of them had only been believers for a short time. So in the verses we're going to look at today, the Apostle Paul teaches these people one of the most amazing lessons in all of Scripture. He tells them that there's going to be a day when Jesus returns to earth. And then what the Apostle Paul does is he paints a vivid picture of exactly what's going to happen when that day arrives. But before we look at these verses, there's something I want you to know. Whenever somebody talks about the second coming of Christ, it has the potential to cause a lot of personal anxiety. And the reason so many people feel that way is because of what some religious person has told them about the second coming of Christ in their past. Because so many of us have heard a pastor or a priest or some Christian person say that in order to go to heaven, you have to be perfect. Because if you aren't perfect, then you won't make it into heaven. Or if Jesus returns and you have some unconfessed sin in your life, you won't make it into eternity. So for those of you who've heard that, been taught that, or this topic has caused you so much stress in your past, here's what I want you to know. As we look at these verses today, I have no intention on scaring you in any way. I'm not going to give you my personal opinion, and I'm also not going to give you a lot of theological mumbo jumbo that doesn't make any sense. All we're going to do is we're going to open up the Bible, and we're going to see what the scriptures have to say about the return of Jesus. So with that in mind, look at what Paul wrote in 1 Thessalonians 4:13. He wrote, "Brothers and sisters, we do not want you to be uninformed." And right away, I want you to see something important. The Apostle Paul loved this church so much that he didn't want them to walk through their life without understanding the truth for themselves. Paul's like, look, I don't want you to be uninformed. I want you to know the truth. And that should be the goal of every pastor. Because every pastor's role is to inform the congregation they lead what the Bible does and does not say. And because Paul was doing it right, he takes the time to inform this church what was going to happen when Christ returns. He said, "Brothers and sisters, we do not want you to be uninformed about those who have fallen asleep in death," which means the people who've already passed away. "We do not want you to be uninformed about those who have fallen asleep in death, so that you do not grieve like the rest of mankind who have no hope." Now, in order for this verse to make sense, I need to take a second and explain what's going on here. If you remember what I said a second ago, the people in Thessalonica had only been believers for a short time. and they were worried about their friends and family members who'd already passed away, because they thought that anybody who died prior to Christ's return would somehow miss out on heaven. That's why Paul said, look, I don't want you to grieve like people who have no hope. I want you to know about what has happened to those who have fallen asleep in death. So what Paul does is, he takes the time to explain what was going to happen to the believers who've already passed away. Look at what he wrote in verse 16. He says, "For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first." So Paul goes, look, I know you're concerned about your friends and family members who've already passed away. But when Jesus returns, what's going to happen is all the believers who've died will rise first and meet Jesus in the air. And then he said, after that, which means after the dead in Christ rise, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. So the Bible tells us that after the dead in Christ, the people who've already passed away, rise to meet Jesus in the air, we who are still on earth will follow, and we will be with the Lord forever. Now you need to know, this isn't all the Bible has to say about the second coming. This was just a section that Paul wrote to this church because they were confused. There is an enormous amount of information in the New Testament that tells us what's going to happen when Christ returns. So what I want to do for the next few minutes is I want to give you four facts that we find in Scripture that tell us exactly what's going to happen when Christ returns, so that you have a better understanding of what's really going to happen. And the first fact you need to know is there will indeed be a day when Jesus returns to earth. Look at what Jesus himself said in Matthew 24. He said, "They will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of the sky with power and great glory. And he will send his angels with a loud trumpet call, and they will gather his elect from one end of the heavens to the other." All throughout the New Testament, Jesus teaches that there will be a day when he returns to earth. And Jesus wasn't the only one who made that promise, because the angels promised the very same thing. Look at what the Bible says in Acts 1:9. It says, "After Jesus said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid them from their sight. The disciples were looking intently up into the sky as he was going, when suddenly, two men dressed in white stood beside them. 'Men of Galilee,' they said, 'why do you stand here looking into the sky? This same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven.'" Jesus was not the only one who promised that he was going to return one day. The angels promised the very same thing. Now, even though Scripture tells us that there will be a day when Jesus returns, the second fact you need to know is nobody knows when that day is going to be. Look at what Jesus said in Matthew 24. He said, "No one knows about that day or hour, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father." You see, the Bible makes it very clear that nobody knows when Christ is going to return. Jesus doesn't know. The angels don't know. God is the only one who knows on the day he's going to look at Jesus and say, "Go back." Now, even though nobody knows when that day is going to be, there have been countless people all throughout history who have unsuccessfully predicted the return of Christ. I mean, there was Joseph Morris, Pope Sylvester II, Henry Archer, Joanna Southcott, Edgar Wisenot, and the list goes on and on and on. In fact, some of you may remember that back in 2011, a guy named Harold Camping predicted that the return of Christ was going to be on May 21st, 2011. In fact, he was so convinced about this that he had people all over the country running around different parts of the world, handing out pamphlets and flyers. He even put up expensive billboards all across the United States warning people about the coming judgment. Now, the funny thing about Camping's prediction is that for several weeks before May 21st happened, there were men and women all over the country who stood on street corners and on blocks holding up signs telling people to repent and believe the good news. And I have to be honest about this. When I first heard Camping's prediction, I thought to myself, this is amazing. And let me tell you why. It's because the angels don't know when Jesus is going to return. Jesus doesn't know when Jesus is going to return. But the guy who looks like he starred in Poltergeist 2 does know. That's just amazing to me, right? So when I first heard about Camping's prediction on May 21st, I decided to have a little bit of fun. What I did was I grabbed one of the staff members and a video camera, and we went downtown to find one of these guys who were standing on the street holding these signs, right? And after about 30 minutes of driving around downtown, we finally found this guy. So we get out of the car, I grab a microphone, and my introduction goes like this. It goes, "Hey everybody, this is Scott from Velocity, and we are downtown Cleveland to film the end of the world." That's right, today at 3:13 p.m., Harold Camping predicted that Jesus is going to return and we're going to capture all of it on film, right? So I'm standing there interviewing this guy, laughing my head off, like, "Hey, it's getting close. Are you getting nervous?" You know, handing back and forth. Well, finally, with about 10 seconds to go, I start counting down, like, 10, here we go. 7, oh my gosh. 5, 4, Jesus, I'm ready. I'm being a total idiot, right? And when 3:13 comes and goes, I look at this guy and I'm like, "Is my watch wrong? Is this Eastern Standard Time?" Right? And so this guy was totally deflated and he walks away in total shame, right? And me and this staff guy are laughing our heads off. But the funniest part of the whole thing was we were both laughing so hard that he forgot to hit record. So I can't even show you the video. Yeah, I know. I said the same thing to him. But here's the point. The point is, there have been countless people all throughout history who have unsuccessfully predicted the return of Christ. And do you know why? Because the Bible says that only Jesus knows when that day is going to be. So if anyone ever says, "I know when it's going to be." No, you don't. You have no idea when Jesus is going to return. Only God knows. Now, even though we don't know when Jesus is going to return, the third fact is, we do know what's going to happen. Look at what Jesus said in Matthew 13. He said, "The kingdom of heaven is like a man who sowed good seed in his field, but while he was sleeping, his enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat and went away. The weeds sprouted and formed heads, and then the weeds also appeared. The owner's servants came to him and said, 'Sir, didn't you sow good seed in your field? Where then did these weeds come from?' 'An enemy did this,' he replied. The servants asked him, 'Do you want us to go and pull them up?' 'No,' he answered, 'because while you're pulling up the weeds, you may pull up the wheat with them. Let them both grow together until the harvest. At that time, I will tell the harvesters, first, collect the weeds, tie them into bundles to be burned. Then gather the wheat and bring it into my barn.'" Now, when Jesus told this story, the disciples had no idea what he was talking about. And I want you to see what happened in verse 36. It says, "Then Jesus left the crowd and went into the house. His disciples came to him and said, can you explain to us the parable of the weeds in the field? Like, we don't understand that." And that's so funny because, here's why. If you are somebody who's ever read the Bible and thought, this makes no sense. I don't get it. Here's the best news for all of our hearts. The disciples were standing there listening to Jesus' story, and it made no sense. And because Jesus was so gracious and because he knew they didn't understand, he took the time to explain what it meant. Look at what he said in verse 37. Jesus answered, "The one who sowed the good seed is the Son of Man." In other words, that's me. "The field is the world, and the good seed stands for the sons of the kingdom. The weeds are the sons of the evil one, and the enemy who sows them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the harvesters are angels." Verse 40, "As the weeds are pulled up and burned in the fire, so it will be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send out his angels, and they will weed out of his kingdom everything that causes sin and all who do evil. Then they will throw them in the fiery furnace, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father." Now, don't miss this. The Bible tells us that when Jesus returns, what he's going to do is there's going to be a moment when he separates, he weeds out the people who knew him from those who didn't. The people who knew him will enter heaven, and those who didn't will be separated from God. And this is the point where so many people start to panic, because their mind starts racing. They're like, "Oh my gosh, am I a weed or my weed? Am I going to get separated? Have I done something? Oh my gosh," right? Here's what you need to know. The Bible makes it very clear that this topic should not cause you concern if you've already given your life to Christ. Because 2 Peter 3:10 says this, "But the day of the Lord will come like a thief." You know what that means? You don't know when you're going to get robbed. You don't know when you're going to get hit by a car. You don't know when you're going to be the victim of a crime. It says the day of the Lord will come like a thief. You don't know when it's going to happen. "The day of the Lord will come like a thief. The heavens will disappear with a roar, and the elements will be destroyed by fire. The earth and everything in it will be," not might be, "will be laid bare." And Peter asked the most gracious question, because what he's doing is he's telling us the truth. Everyone's like, "Oh, the earth and the elements is going to be tipped fire." Wait, he's like, "This is what's going to happen. Here's the truth." And here's the question he asked in verse 11. He says, "Since everything's going to be destroyed in this way, what kind of people ought you to be?" It's the best question. He's like, "Look, since you know now, you've given your life to Christ and you understand, this world's just temporary. Even if you live to be 120, in the spectrum of eternity, your time on earth is so short and the earth's not going to last forever anyway. And since everything's going to be destroyed one day, how do you think you should live?" He says, "Well, you ought to live holy and godly lives as you look forward to." You don't fear it. "As you look forward to the day of God and the speed of its coming." And the next sentence says, "That day will bring about the destructions of heaven by fire, and the elements will melt in the heat. But in keeping with his promise, we look forward to a new heaven and a new earth, the home of righteousness." And you know what his promise was? He goes, "But in keeping with his promise, we," you and I, "look forward to." And you know what God's promise was? It's so simple. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life." It's not complex. His promise was so simple. He's like, "Look, once you believe this, then you have all of heaven and eternity to look forward to." We don't fear it. We're not afraid of it, right? We have no reason to be afraid of the return of Christ. It's something that we should look forward to. And you know why we shouldn't be afraid? It's because heaven is going to be your eternal home. And nobody's afraid of their home. Nobody's afraid of their house. Because your house is where the people who love you live. Your family is there. And when you gave your life to Christ, you became a part of God's family. That's why 1 John 3:1 says, "How great, like, oh my gosh, I can't believe he would love me this much." how great is the love the Father has lavished on us that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. You see, when you gave your life to Christ, you became a member of his family and you secured your place in heaven. And the reason so many of us have such a hard time going, that's true. I just believe that. There's always this, yeah, but what about, and I'm not sure, and if God grids on a bell-shaped curve, but what about, and you know why so many of us have a hard time understanding and believing that? It's because of what we've been taught in our past. And I'm going to be very honest about this. This topic used to scare me to death. Whenever somebody would talk, especially when I was in my early 20s and I just had given my life to Christ, when somebody would talk about the return of Christ, I could literally feel my heart start beating and my anxiety go up because I'm not an anxious person, but I'm like, oh my gosh, like I hope. And then I would debate back and forth and well, I'm better than, and I don't know. And here's why. The reason this used to scare me so much is because I didn't understand it for myself. In fact, when anybody in my world got sick or kind of would like, I knew they were going to die, I would kind of avoid, like, I kind of want to go see them, but I kind of don't because, man, I hope. And I was just, it was the weirdest thing. It's probably just me. I don't know if anybody else feels that way, but I used to be terrified about death and about the second coming of Jesus. In fact, years ago, a really good friend of mine, my next door neighbor growing up, her name is Luann Benedict. When she was in her early 20s, she was diagnosed with cancer. She had this big tumor that grew on the back of her neck. But Luann fought hard. And for about a year, she just kept fighting, chemo treatment, surgery. And finally, Luann was good enough where she was like, man, you beat it. You beat this cancer. But about 2 years later, her cancer came back. And this time, it was brutal. Because the cancer didn't just affect the back of her head. It had spread through her lymph nodes, through her spine, through her bones. And it got to be the point where it was so bad. My mom called me one Saturday. I was actually living in another state. My mom called me and said, look, Scott, if you want to say goodbye to Luann, you need to come home. She's not going to make it. And to be honest, now you got to picture this. I was at this point in my life in seminary getting ready to become a pastor. And for that 5.5 hour drive, I was absolutely terrified because I didn't know what I was going to tell her, right? Because the whole thought of death and the second coming of Jesus, I just didn't understand kind of that world. But I drove home, and that Saturday morning, I went to her house. I walked in, hugged her mom and dad because I knew them really, really well. And then I walked into Luann's room. And when I walked into her room, she was laying in her bed and she looked like death. So I pulled up a chair and sat beside her. I put my hand on her hand and I tried to make small talk. And it was so unhelpful because I wasn't encouraging. I was afraid. And I'm like, man, I hope that she's going to be okay. I know she's given her life to Christ. I just hope and pray. And it, like, I can't explain what a disaster I was in that house that morning. Because I think I was like just so unhelpful. But about 30 minutes into this time I was visiting, the pastor from her church came in the door. His name is Harry Carmichael. He was in his mid-60s. And if there was ever a guy who I honestly think like, you understand the Bible and you're just different, it was him. And when he came in the house, I was still in the room with Luann. He came in the house, talked to the parents for a few minutes. And when he walked into Luann's room, he got this huge smile on his face. And he walks up to Luann, like right up to her bed. He puts his hand on her leg and he smiles at her. And he goes, Luann, Luann. And she looked at him. And he goes, don't be afraid. Honey, don't be afraid. You go be with Jesus. And at that moment, she died. And it was one of those moments where I was like, I can't believe that just happened. And the coroner came and people came and they took her out and Harry was still there. And before he left, because I am the world's biggest nerd. I'm like, you're not going to leave until I know what I need to know. I pulled him aside and I go, how did you do that? How were you able to say those words and know that everything was really going to be okay? And he looked at me in the weirdest tone. He was like, Scott, if you belong to Jesus, there is no fear in death. And his words made a permanent mark on my heart. And I remember over the years, over the past 26 years, I have said those very same words to people who I knew weren't going to make it. Hey, don't you be afraid. Don't you be afraid. You go be with Jesus. Because Harry was right. There are four things that we can be sure of as it relates to the return of Christ. First, Jesus is going to return. No one knows when it's going to be. We do know what's going to happen. And this topic should not cause you concern in any way if you have given your life to Christ. Now, for those of you who are like, but I still wonder, like, am I really okay? You need to work through a really simple process because people make this so complicated when God made it extraordinarily simple. If you are someone who would say, I really believe that Jesus is God's son who died on the cross for my sin, congratulations, then you have already given your heart and your life to Jesus. And the next step is you celebrate that decision by being baptized. It's just that simple. It's not about church attendance. It's not about the songs that you sing. It's not how many times you eat crackers and juice on Sunday. Your relationship with God is defined by, what do I believe? And do I really believe that Jesus is God's son? And if you're somebody who's never made that decision, like, I kind of believe it, but I've never been baptized, and I've always kind of wanted to do that. Listen, there's a sign-up sheet right here in the lobby. As a matter of fact, we have two or three other people who are actually getting baptized today. If you'd like, and that doesn't have to be today, if you'd like to do that over the next couple months, or you've got some questions on the way out, you sign that piece of paper. You just sign that up. I'd be happy to sit down and talk with you, because the truth is, there's no fear as it relates to this topic in your life. Let me pray for all of us. God, first off, thank you. Because, like, it would be mean if you didn't tell us the truth. Like, if you didn't tell us what was going to happen when Jesus returned, that would be mean. If you didn't tell us that Jesus was going to return, that would have been mean too. But the truth is, you love us so much that you didn't just give us your son. You didn't just give us the church for community. You didn't just give us marriage and love and all the amazing gifts. What you did was you gave us the exact details of what's going to happen when your son returns. The dead in Christ are going to rise. We're going to follow. There's going to be a day when it happens. We don't need to be afraid in any capacity if we're a part of your family. I mean, when people wonder, like, how much do you love us? Like, oh my gosh. You laid this out for us in a way that's so simplistic. And the thing that I love is what Peter wrote. He said, we look forward to. We don't fear it. So God, my heart and my hope is for the people who sit here today. And even though they read the Bible verses and they heard what it said, they're still afraid. Like, oh my gosh, what's going to happen? Would you, maybe God, maybe for the first time ever, would you erase all that anxiety? And would you allow us to just be confident knowing that Jesus was enough? Because that's what you said. that your grace is sufficient. And it's that simple. So Lord, for the people who are kind of in that world of fear and am I enough, don't let them live that way. Because I did for so long. And that's just no place to live. So God, my hope is for all of us, even the people who are kind of wondering, like, man, where do I fall in the spectrum of belief and unbelief and is Jesus and all that stuff? Would you just maybe kind of renew something in their own minds and help them to see something they've never seen before? But God, above all, thank you for telling us the truth. And thank you for loving us that much. And it's in Jesus' name we pray.